Okay, this video is about Diels-Alder regioselectivity. If you take this diene and this dienophile, you'll get this product. That's the only possible product you can get. And the reason for that is that the diene is symmetrical. Similarly, if you take this diene and this dienophile, there's only one possible product once again, and that's because the dienophile is symmetrical. Okay, but what happens if we have an unsymmetrical diene and an unsymmetrical dienophile? There's two possible products. There's this 1-3 product and this 1-4 product. Is there going to be any selectivity between the two? Well, actually there is. And if you do the reaction, you can measure the outcome and then try to reason why you get more of one product than the other. So it turns out we get more of this 1-4 product than the 1-3. And this has been looked at with a whole range of different Diels-Alder reactions, and some general trends have been noted, and then the reactions have been rationalized. Now, in this day and age, computational chemistry has come a really long way, so we can do computational chemistry to look for the transition state leading to the 1-3 product, and the transition state leading to the 1-4 product, and we'll find there's an energy difference between them, and if we do computational work at the right level of theory, we can rationalize the results based on those transition state energies. But before those high power computations became possible or easy to do, you could rationalize these sorts of reactions by just looking at the HOMO of the diene and the LUMO of the dienophile for an ordinary Diels-Alder reaction, where the HOMO diene and LUMO dienophile interaction is the most important, so they're the closest to the energy. So it's fairly easy to calculate or at least estimate what the orbitals look like, what the orbital coefficients look like in the HOMO of this diene. So when I'm talking about orbital coefficients, we're looking at the molecular orbital, the HOMO, we're looking at how big is this sort of electron density at that position. It turns out with this molecule, we have a really large coefficient on the alpha position at the end of the chain here. So the HOMO looks like this. And we have fairly small coefficients in the other positions. So the HOMO looks like that. And then if we look at the LUMO of the dienophile, we see a similar asymmetry. So we have a small coefficient on that alpha carbon and a large coefficient on the beta carbon. And so the LUMO for this dienophile looks like that. And it turns out that to predict the major product of these reactions, we just have to bring the HOMO and the LUMO together so that the largest coefficients overlap. And that will happen one way around and not the other. And we'll get the best overall overlap for that Diels-Alder transition state. Now, there are guidelines about how to estimate these HOMOs and LUMOs and what the orbital coefficients will be. I won't go into that now, but we'll look at one of the simplest cases and a case where you can use a little trick. So with this particular reaction, we can use a trick in that the HOMO and the LUMO here can be estimated by just looking at resonance structures for these compounds. So if we look at this methoxy-substituted diene and push electrons in like this onto that alpha carbon, then we can draw a resonance form for this molecule where we have a negative charge at that position there and a positive charge on the oxygen. Okay, and similarly, we can draw a resonance form for the cyano group. So if we just expand that cyano group, so I'll just do it quickly here. So there's the cyano group. We know that's an electron withdrawing group and it can accept electrons through its pi system, so it's conjugated with that double bond. If we draw the result of those arrows, we'll get a resonance form which has a positive charge at that position, and a negative charge on the nitrogen. Now, these resonance forms contribute to the overall structure and the reactivity of the molecules that they're related, that they're a resonance contributor to. So if we've got a positive charge here, that says that we've got a partial positive charge in the structure, and then partial negative charge on that nitrogen. And similarly, we've got a partial negative charge on that carbon there. I won't put a partial positive charge on the oxygen because, you know, it's an electron withdrawing element. So it's only through the pi system that it has this formal positive charge. Through the sigma system, it's electron withdrawing. Anyway, importantly, if we look at the reacting atoms, we've got a partial positive charge on that carbon there, and a partial negative charge on that carbon there. And it turns out that predicts correctly the desire, the major isomer from this reaction. And it's the same as the result we get when we calculate the HOMO and the LUMO. And we can do that for other simple substituted dienes and dienophiles where we have strongly electron withdrawing groups and strongly electron donating groups. Okay, so that's a little brief introduction to Diels-Alder regioselectivity.